Hi, this is Damien Marie AtHope, and I am an axiological atheist, which can simply be understood as a value theory or a value science atheist. And today, I'm going to do a little bit on paganism, such as that scene beginning in Turkey about 12,000 years ago, at such sites as Gobekli Tepe, the first human-made temple, dating to around 12,000 years ago, but also connected to Sedentism, and thus the creation of goddesses around 12,000 years ago, as well as male gods sometime after 7,000 years ago. There is a pagan slash possible shaman burial in Israel dated to about 12,000 years ago. And there is 12,000 to 10,000 year old art that seems to be either paganistic or shamanistic in a remote cave in Egypt. Not to mention the skull cult that starts at around 11,500 to 8,400 years ago. Also, there is, of course, Catal, Huyuk, which is the first religious design city, dating to around 10,000 years ago. This all brings me to the understanding that I like to explain that to me, religion is an evolved product. In a general way, it all starts with pre-animism, but then leads to animism, in a sense which is a theoretical belief in supernatural powers or spirits. And this physically is expressed in or with, in a sense, the later totemism. That is about 50,000 years ago, where animism is about 100,000 years ago. Totemism is a theoretical belief, to me, in a mystical relationship with powers and spirits through a totem item, which would, of course, elicit the need for possible full-time special persons to perform this religion or believed worship interactions with things like totemism. Thus, to me, brings the emergence of shamanism about 30,000 years ago, a theoretical belief in the access and influence of spirits and powers through ritual. In addition, there is further employment of myths or deities added to all the above, which to me is paganism at about 12,000 years ago, and is often, especially at its beginning, a more nature-based than the paganism that will come later, and certainly more than the current top world religions, thus hinting at their close link, though, to the more ancient form of religion. And all this thinking should help us understand that it's an evolved product. It is a thing that kept being transmitted, changed, and developed. My hypothesis is expressed in the sense in the understanding of building like a theoretical house. Modern religious development at its full form. It seems that ancient people who had survived amazing threats in a dangerous universe were then filled with lots of superstition. And this perceived superstitious thinking applied the concepts of good and evil to the world of human, in a sense, the recognizing or the belief that humans had an imperfection, the immorality and imperfection of the soul, which was thought to affect the still living, thus connecting itself to ancestor worship. Presumably, this ancestor worship led to the belief in supernatural beings, which some were turned into the belief of gods. This feeble myth we call gods are just a human conceived idea that was made from relatively nothing. And it started to be put into something, this concept, again and again, over and over, changing as it went, taking on more, evolving more, all the while they're still thought to be true and special. However, a clear understanding sees them for what they are, a supernatural, animistic spirit believed, still thought to be sacred. The Neolithic began in Iran about 10,000 years ago. It is a 10,000-year-old Neolithic Tepe Tel, in a sense, from Iran. The early Neolithic is somewhere around 12,000 years ago, beginning to at least the beginning parts to 11,000 years ago. And it perceived, in a sense, this happened before the use of pottery, and it also then lately followed quickly, the use of tools, and still exclusively, especially flint and wood tools, and the use of new fibers. Crude figurines of sheep, goats, pigs, dogs, cattle, and people were often made in unbaked clay. People sometimes wore bracelets, pendants, beads, skirts, pierced their lips with labrets, and deliberately displayed, in a sense, deformed skulls. Barrels were normally placed under the floors of houses or in some part of an open settlement, usually though within the walls of the place, sometimes that of an abandoned house. Sedentism, farming, and agriculture were invented at least by 10,000 years ago in a region between southeastern Anatolia or Turkey, Iran, Iraq, and Syria, and are traditionally labeled as, in a sense, the Northern Fertile Crescent. Most of the technology and culture associated with farming include other things like domesticated sheep, goats, cattle, pig. The transition from hunter-gatherer lifestyle to agriculture and sedentism is considered the aspects of what becomes the Neolithic Revolution. And I believe that this also carries the Neolithic paganism with it. Around 2,000 years later, the new Neolithic lifestyle appears in southeastern Europe and shortly afterwards in Central Europe and the Mediterranean Europe. The earliest farmers from the Zagros Mountains of Iran, such as the eastern part of the Fertile Crescent in the north and the east, are either, in a sense, the main ancestors of some of Europeans' first farmers, but they are not exactly considered to be part of the modern Europeans. Early farmers across Europe have an almost unbroken trail, in a sense, of ancestry leading them back to somewhere likely in northwest Anatolia or Turkey. But it now seems that this chain of migration into Europe breaks somewhere in eastern Turkey. Neolithic settlers from northern Greece and the area region seas of western Turkey reached central Europe via the Balkan route and the Iberian Peninsula via the Mediterranean route. These colonists brought the new sedentary lifestyle, agriculture, animal domestications and plants, as well as, to me, Neolithic paganism into Europe. New research shows that some of the world's earliest farmers from Iran were genetically distinct group and only very distant related to the first farmers in Western Anatolia and Europe. People who are genetically so different, who almost certainly look different, spoke different language, adopted seemingly similar agricultural lifestyles, and to me with it, that new emergence of paganism. Almost simultaneously, they did this in different parts of Turkey and the Middle East or Near East. The group of prehistoric inhabitants of the Zagros Mountains separated as far back as 50,000 years ago from other people of Eurasia and were among the first to have invented farming. It is that some of the Neolithic practitioners, in a sense, started moving from there. But the majority of ancient Iranians do not move west, as some would have thought. However, they did move east, and this study has shown this. Research team found that Iranian genomes represent the main ancestors of modern-day South Asians. While sharing many segments of their genomes with Afghani and Pakistani populations, the almost 10,000-year-old genomes from Iran, Zagros Mountains, were found to be the most similar with the modern-day Zoroastrians from Iran. It seems that at least two highly divergent groups became the world's first farmers, at least. And this would be the Zagros people of the Neolithic Eastern Fertile Crescent part of the Neolithic zone that was ancestral, as I said, to most modern South Asians, and the Aegean that was colonized Europe some 8,000 years ago. There seems to be some possible archaeological origins for early Proto-Indo-European in the Baltic during the Mesolithic. At a stone cemetery located in the north shore of northern Levatia, using many individuals to test from, there observed a transition from hunter-gatherer genes related ancestry that adopted that is the opposite of that seen in Ukraine. And the Mesolithic and early Neolithic individuals associated with the Kunda and the Narva cultures have ancestry that immigrated, and it's about 70% from the one, and then about 30% from another. And we also detect a shift in the ancestry between early Neolithic peoples and those associated with the Middle Neolithic, such as the Combeware complex, and who were more, in a sense, related to the 30% population. The cemetery contained 330 burials, with roughly equal numbers of male and female, although one-third of the burials are children. The principal grave goods are animal tooth pendants, occurring in both adult and child graves. A small number of male and female graves contain hunting and fishing equipment, including harpoons, spears, arrowheads, fishhooks. The early burials are dated to the Middle Mesolithic, or about 10,000 years ago, but they continue through the Stone Age, extending over at least 4,000 years. In Europe, in the span of roughly 15,000 to 5,000 years ago, is the Mesolithic. In Southwest Asia, the Epiolithic Near East, roughly 20,000 to 8,000. The term is less used in areas further east and is not used beyond Eurasia and North Africa. The term epiolithic is often used synonymously, especially outside of Northern Europe, and for corresponding period in the Levant and the Cossacks. Mesolithic societies are not seen as very complex. They have burials, and they're fairly simple. And they have burial mounds are another mark of the Neolithic. The Mesolithic suggests an emergence period followed by the Neolithic. And since so it's hunter-gatherers between that or farmers in a sense. And the Mesolithic cultures who were clearly succeeded by the Neolithic Revolution include things like the Nufian culture. The Baltic Mesolithic begins about 15,000 years ago. In Western Europe, the early Mesolithic begins about 14,000 years ago. And in the Franco-Caribbean region of northern Spain and southern France is also 14,000. And in other parts of Europe, it begins about 11,500 years ago. And lasts until basically the emergence of farming, at least in Europe, 8,500 to 5,500 years ago. In Northern Europe, for example, societies were able to live well on rich food supplies. And in a sense, such traditions produce distinctive human behaviors, and as perceived in the material record of artifacts, such as different cultures. Anyways, there is such conditions also display the oncoming Neolithic in Northern Europe by 5,500 years ago. A culture very small to the or similar to the Aztlan spread as well into the Mediterranean, Spain, and southern Portugal. Because it lacked bone industry, it is named distinctly different. There's a location, Tel Carmel, which has the first tower structures, and they're from Syria. And its significance is probably religious, since there's several towers, and you would not need this, and certainly there wasn't probably any large forces attacking them back then. War starts about 10,000 years ago. This site is dated from 13,000 to 11,650. It also seems to be connected to the skull coat. And that kind of megalithic architecture could also relate and has some similarities to Gobekli Tepe. So it seems that there was maybe a comet impact or something that happened that caused the abrupt change of climate in the Younger Dryas. The Younger Dryas is about 12,900 years ago until 11,700 years ago. And it's a return to glacial conditions and temporary reversing of warmer climates. It is thought to have caused the decline in strength of things at the North Pole. Anyways, the Younger Dryas effects were varying in intensity, especially throughout North America. In Western North America, its effects were less intense than in Europe and the Northeastern North America. However, evidence of re-advancing glaciers indicates the Younger Dryas cooling occurred also in the Pacific Northwest. Replacement of forests in Scandinavia with glacial tundra increase in snow amounts in mountain ranges around the world, formations of deposits such as in Northern Europe. More dust was in the atmosphere, obtaining from the deserts of Asia. A decline in evidence of Nufian hunter-gatherer permanent settlements at this time in the Levant, suggesting reversion back to a more mobile way of life and less sedentism. Decline also of the Clovis culture in America, and the extinction of megafauna game that the North American Paleo-Indians were hunting. The Younger Dryas is often linked to also the Neolithic Revolution itself and the adoption of agriculture in the Levant. It is argued that the colder, drier Younger Dryas lowered the carrying capacity of the area and forced a sedentary early Newfian population into more mobile cistician patterns. Further climate brought more problems. Early swastikas are found uncovered in Ukraine on ivory figures, which dates to about 12,000 years ago. One of the earliest cultures known to have used a swastika was a Neolithic culture in southern Europe. It is known now in places like Serbia, Croatia, Bosnia. It is known for the Vinic culture, which dates to about 8,000 years ago. Also seen in Nordic myths, Odin is represented as passing through the space of a whirling disc. It looks like a swastika, looking down through all the world. In North America, the swastika is used by the Navajos. It was used by the Phoenician symbol for the sun, and it was a sacred symbol used also to represent a priestess. Hindu, the right-handed swastika is a symbol of the god Vishnu and the sun, while the left-handed swastika is a symbol of Kali and magic. The double meaning of the symbol is common in ancient traditions, like an example of a symbol of a five-pointed star, which is viewed in a sense to be negative as pointing if it's pointing downwards, and positive if it's pointing upwards. And I think that this also relates to how some goddesses are seen as warlike and yet loving, dual nature. I also think that relates to probably the sun and the moon, or stars in the night and the star in the day. In Bronze Age Europe, the sun cross appears most frequently in things and often is interpreted as a solar symbol. Swastika shapes have been found in numerous artifacts from Iron Age Europe, Greco-Roman, Lithuanian, Etruscan, Baltic, Celtic, Germanic, Slav, and Georgian. This prehistory seems to reflect the appearance of the symbol in various folk arctic cultures of Europe, to me believed to be connected to paganism. The symbol has been found in vessels in ancient cities of Troy. The evidence shows that it served as a symbol of fertility and a symbol of life. Its similar use can be found in graves in Greece and Athenian vessels and decorating garments of Aphrodite, the Greek goddess of love. Also, Greek pantheon, the symbol of the Greek design, as used with other designs. The swastika is defined a European sign moving eastward into the Indus Valley, or India civilization. It is thought it was brought by migrating tribes to India, where it became connected with religious and cultural life in Indo-Iranians. It did not originate in the Indus Valley, as many people have thought. And like I said, I think that probably the general thing is that this is a star symbol or a sun symbol. So Turkey, spreading early Neolithic paganism around 9,000 years ago. DNA reflects westward movements of people from the Near East around 9,000 years ago, especially from Turkey, and to me, spreading early paganism as it went. by leapfrogging from island to island across the northern Mediterranean, Neolithic people were able to quickly spread their farming lifestyle across southern Europe. Some 9,000 years ago, this is what genetics suggests. It seems that sometime after individuals in the Aries first developed farming and herding around 12,000 years ago, and to me also invented the new paganism religion for agriculture, they later transferred it and its new agricultural religion of early paganism out to many others. The genetic expression that people from the Near East migrated into Turkey and then rapidly west through the islands of Greece, Sicily, before making their way north into the center of the continent of Europe. People living in central Turkey today, for example, share DNA with Sicilians and Palestinians. But Sicilians and Palestinians are mutations that the two populations do not have in common. People have common ancestral roots in Turkey, but have not had much contact in a sense since. People even living around the Mediterranean today have common ancestors in Turkey because of this. But the genes diverge in two major different sets, with the Greek islands and Crete forming a sort of genetic bridge to the rest of Greece, Sicily, Italy, and into Northern Europe. Genetics of modern-day Egyptians, Libyans, Tuscans, Moroccans from a separate genetic branch, thus two distinct paths lacking, in a sense, much genetic mingling once they separate ways from south and north from Turkey. However, there is some evidence found, such as blades in the Neolithic settlements in Etruscan, made from volcanic glass that comes from the isolated islands near Sicily. Agriculture and its new Neolithic religion of early paganism spread across the land through Central and Northern Europe at a rate of about a half a mile a year, thus taking 1,000 years or so to journey from the Balkans to Germany. But the Mediterranean was quite different. With this new pagan farmers jumping from island to island, getting from Italy all the way to Portugal in the space of just 6 generations. So, I want to address the connections of the islands. So the Kripot culture of Cyprus, ancient Kripot art, refers in a sense to all works of visual art originating from Cyprus, and they begin about 12,000 years ago. Seasonal hunters came to go after pygmy hippopotamuses and elephants that were present on the island. The first Neolithic settlers in Cyprus originated from either the Syro-Palestine coast or southern Anatolia itself, forming communities founded on this new agriculture. It was towards the end of the Neolithic people when these people began to bake modern clay vessels, which were frequently embellished with abstract designs in red on a light strip. During this period, a flood of Syro-Palestinian and Anatolian or Turkey migrants introduced a more advanced set of culture and, of course, the religion. Whereas the religion was practiced now with art and processes became more complex. Examples of such art are of importance, like the female figurines formed of clay or stone, which represent fertility as one of the crucial values of agrarian societies at that time. Middle Bronze Age, between 3,900 years ago and 3,650 years ago has contacts with Egypt, the Near East, Minoan Crete, the Mycenaean Greece. Despite the continuation of agriculture, certain developments have diversified and burial practices have proceeded. The building of unique religious installations, as well as seals, indicating a more sophisticated society emerging. Crypto-Minoan script was regularly used on the island of Cyprus and by the crypto-migrants overseas during the Late Bronze Age. Although it is still undecipherable in a sense, the sign sequence inscribed on miniature ox ingots and associated with clay tablets may hold a clue to their purpose in writing. The ingots were previously interpreted as gift grave offerings, in a sense, described with dictations. It suggested that they were extremely pure copper and they were produced in a sense like a commercial way. They were marked with band and seemed to have a high quality. So there's a real understanding of how close, in a sense, the connection of these islands are with the peoples that were migrating from Turkey and then thus transferring their languages and religion ideas. Genomes can tell us a lot, and there could be some tool technology that begins with Neanderthals and is transferred to hunter-gatherers. And we do know that there is certainly Neanderthals in the region, that the Agrarian culture, and there could be connections even with the hunter-gatherers later in Iran. And it makes me think about, what about the Gravedians and the Epigravedian cultures and their connections also with Iran and Turkey? And certainly there may be a connection with the Nufian culture. And the genome of a 30 to 50 year old woman from Ganja Dara shows analysis that she belonged to Halogroup X, and is similar to the Antonine early farmers and the Cossack hunter-gatherers. And this woman was found in Iran. The presence of mitochondrial Halogroup X in Atlanteans from southern Siberia also is interesting. Anthropomorphically, southern Antonolans and typical for Central Asian Mongoloids, like the Mongolians, the Yurts, and the Buryks, whereas northern Atlanteans exhibit some Caucasoidal features similar to Eurocratic groups. Clay tokens from Susa, a site in Iran, are seen as a composite photograph type of images, in a sense. They were tokens that are about 5,000 years old, and some of the tokens have sphere shapes and disc shapes, cone shapes, you know. The more elaborate tokens seem to have marks on them and with impressions or lines. And the tokens with varying shapes and markings, also some can be, in a sense, equated with early Sumerian. Early geometric tokens are found in sites in the Ziggurat Mountains of Iran at Tepe Ashwab and Ganji-e-Dara Tepe. And proto-Elamite pottery dating back to at least half of the 5th millennium and has been found at Tepe Shayak, where proto-Elamite writing and the first forms of writing possibly seen in Iran have been found on tablets to this date. The first cylinder seals also come from the proto-Elamite period as well. There's been found at least 52 tokens that represent 12 major categories of tokens with incised characters that appear, in a sense, in early Sumerian inscriptions. Most of the inscriptions cannot be totally read, but their meaning connected to symbols. And the Sumerian numeral symbols equivocate the various spherical conal shapes that are found in other tablets. For instance, the spheres have incised lines added. And in a cone, there's a circular punch mark added. Neolithic graves from central China may have the world's first writing, such as signs carved in 8,600-year-old tortoise shells, which could have involved shamanistic rattles. Tortoise shells were found in 24 Neolithic graves excavated in the province of northern China, dating to around 8,600 years ago. According to some archaeologists, the symbols carved in the shells had similarities to the around 3,250 to 3,200-year-old oracle bone script, which was a form of Chinese characters used in oracle bones, such as the bones of turtles, and used, believed to be used for divination, like magic. In ancient Mesopotamia, the turtle was associated with the god Iki and was used on one of Iki's symbols. In the myth of the Ninturra, the turtle, Iki thwarts an attempt of the god Ninturra to seize absolute power by creating a giant turtle. And the turtle bites the hero's ankle. They struggle, and the turtle digs and spits into a claw, with both of them falling into a pit. And therefore, the ideas of the heroine or hero and the turtle connecting to ancient Sumerian story. Chinese bronze script characters for Tan, or the heaven, is represented by a figure, a man figure, it looks like, or a anthropomorphic human figure, is one of the oldest Chinese terms for heaven, and the concept is seen in Chinese mythology, philosophy, and religion, and it is seen on the oracle bone script. Oracle bone script to me and the Tan or sky god to me could have connections to the early monotheistic religions. Single god religions or monotheism, which I call as a negative term, manotheism, since it really cares a lot about men, there really isn't any single goddess religions, but the so monotheism, in a sense, is relating to, in a sense, this emergence of male dominance. And I think it starts about 4,000 years ago. Tan is one of the oldest Chinese terms of heaven. During the Sang Dynasty, the 17th to 11th centuries BCE, the Chinese referred to their supreme god as Xing'e, Lord on High, Ding Lord. During the following Zun Dynasty, Tan became synonymous with this figure. Heaven worship was, before the 20th century, an orthodox state religion in China. In Taoism and Confucianism, Tan is a celestial aspect of the cosmos, often translated as heaven. It is mentioned as a relationship with aspects of Di, the earth. These two aspects of Taoist cosmology are representative of Taoism. They are thought to maintain the two poles of the three realms of reality. The middle realm is occupied by humanity. The lower realm is occupied by demons and ghosts. The first Shang means high, highest, first primordial, and second Ding is typically considered as short for Hengai. In modern Chinese, the title of Emperor of China, first employed by Qinxing Heng, and is usually translated as emperor. The word itself is derived from three Heng and five Ding, including Yellow Emperor, the mythological originator of the Chinese civilization, and the ancestor believed to the Chinese race. However, the different symbol or same symbol can refer to the high god of Shang, meaning the deity manifestation of God. Thus, the name Xing should be translated as highest deity, but also have been given the meaning of the sense a primordial deity or a first deity seen in classical Chinese. The deity preceded the title of Emperor of China and were named after him, their role in the Tanzi, the Sons of Heaven, and the classical texts. The high conception of the heavens is frequently identified with Shang Di, who is described as somewhat anthropomorphically. He is also associated with the polar star. The conceptions of the supreme ruler, Shang Di, and the sublime heavens, Hung Tin, afterwards were absorbed by each other. The earliest references of Shang were found in oracle bone scripts of Shang Dynasty around 4,000 years ago, although it was seen in later classical works and story. There's claims of an early significance, such as the Emperor Shun. Even before the Zhang Dynasty, the Shang Di is a recognition of two Chinese characters that are modern Chinese in origin now. The title of Emperors of China first employed under Xing or Sandy, or his later names, the deity received sacrifices from the rulers of China and every Chinese dynasty. Actually, a great temple of heaven in the imperial capital. Following the principles of Chinese, this would also be located in the southern quarters of the city. During the ritual, a completely healthy bull would be slaughtered and presented as the animal of sacrifice to Shang Di. It was important role to know Shang Di is never represented as either images or idols. Instead, the center building of the Temple of Heaven The structure is called the Imperial Vault of Heaven, a spirit table. Inscribed with the name of Shang Di is stored on the throne. During annual sacrifice, the emperor would carry these tablets to the north of the Temple of Heaven, place it on a prayer hall for good harvests, and place them on that throne. It is during the Ming and Qing dynasty that the Roman Catholicism was introduced, and the concept of Shang Di started to be applied to the concept of a Christian god. While initially, this god utilized the term Tanzu, gradually changed in translation to Shang Di instead. The use of Shang Di was contested by Confucians, that they believed that the concept of Tan and Xing is different than the Christian's idea of God. Christian's God, in a sense, is seen as a creator and thus different. But to me, a lot of this stuff is still the same things. An 8,000-year-old veiled mother goddess was seen in northwest Bulgaria, the earliest deity of Europe's first agriculturists. And it was, in a sense, the head of a Neolithic goddess, in a sense, an earlier deity of Europe's first sedentary farmers. And it was found together with prehistoric artifacts from the settlement of Mayor Uznao in northwest Bulgaria. The Balkan megalith area is not that far after leaving Turkey. And shortly into the Balkans, we have the Vinic culture, or the Tudor's Vinic culture, contemporary sites, and Neolithic agriculture, in a sense, in Serbia and smaller parts, Romania, especially Transylvania, dated to around 7,700 years ago to 6,500 years ago. The Vinic culture occupied a region of southeastern Europe in the Balkans, corresponding mainly to modern-day Serbia and Kosovo, but lesser in Romania, Bulgaria, Bosnia, Montenegro, Republic of Macedonia, Greece. Named for its type of sites, a large tell settlements representing material remains of prehistoric society. Farming technology first introduced to the region during the first temperate Neolithic was developed further by the Vinic culture, fueling a population boom and producing some of the largest settlements in prehistoric Europe. These settlements maintained a high degree of cultural uniformity throughout long distance of exchange in connection with ritual items, but they were probably not politically unified. Various styles of zoomorphic and anthropomorphic figures are hallmarks of this culture, as are the Vinic symbols, believed to be in early writing. In some conjecture, the earliest form of this proto-writing. Although it's not considered part of the Copper Age, the culture provides some of the earliest examples of metallurgy, of copper. And this Neolithic writing, and it can be seen on clay amulets, as part of the tablets of the Tarakha date to around 7,500 years ago to 7,300 years ago and are associated with the Vinic culture and Turdus culture. The Vinic symbols and the symbolism, since kind of predates what is seen as the Proto-Sumerian pictographs script. Vinic culture seems to flourish about 8,000 years ago to 6,000 years ago. Another part of the Vinic legacy are the curious masks. Most importantly, the costumed figures, sometimes depicting women in extremely modern-looking like clothes with thin, narrow skirts, sleeveless upper body panels, complementary hip belts, aprons, jewelry, shoes, caps, different hairstyles, bracelets, necklaces, medallions. Archaeological data shows that the Neolithic expansions from Turkey was not a single event, but represents by several ways of migration. In this respect, the proto-Silco culture in Greece, from which directly the Sakurdo, Chris, and the Northern Balkans, and the linear black pottery from Central Europe originate, represents only the first of a few great waves of Neolithization of Europe. The later great waves of migrations from northwest Anatolia led to important cultures of southeastern Europe, such as the Vinic and the Bosan cultures. Secondly, there is a total absence of ADNA from Southeast Europe in the current models. Variability of DNA from 63 individuals recovered at 10 archaeological sites in Romania spanning a period of 8,300 years ago to 3,100 years ago, between the early and the late Neolithic Bronze Age in Romania. This is a area of southeastern Europe from which different prehistoric human groups have passed through and later spread into Europe. Early Neolithic Starocris culture, the MDNA observed in samples are from the early Neolithic Romania that were assorted into European hologroups H, HV, J, and T1A. Hologroup H is the most frequent in present-day European populations, and the hologroup J and T1 are suggested to be markers of the Neolithic diffusion from the Near East. The remains of some of the oldest civilization of Europe is seen in the Vinic culture on the banks of the Danube, not far from Belgrade. The largest Neolithic settlements in Europe date back to about 9,000 years ago, considered to have been the center of civilization spread. The new territories in Bosnia, Serbia, Romania, Bulgaria, Montenegro, Macedonia, and Greece. And the archaeological sites in the Vinic culture reveal different kinds of tools and weapons made from stone, bone, pottery, and jewelry, etc. And they had the remains of prehistoric houses, and many other objects was created and brought from remote areas. What makes this site so, in a sense, unique is a large number of identical objects, indicating that people had some sort of a standardized production in the late Stone Age. These woven vessels and V-neck with certain style and design had, in a sense, been placed with houses who had furniture and were created, in a sense, even beautiful pottery. And these people thus seemed to love to travel, for they were traveling everywhere and collecting items or having them transferred to them. They would have traveled to the Carpathians in order to get volcanic glass used for their weapons. And they bought different objects from far lands and from different cultures. Copper caused numerous wars and the disappearance of Divinic culture. While the people were good at making figurines and jewelry and tools out of copper, the Divinic people were mostly a peaceful civilization and thus possibly leading to their downfall. Among unearthed artifacts, there have been a large number of figurines made of clay depicting worship of deities and women with miniskirts. It is hard to believe that these kind of women were portrayed this way several millennia ago in miniskirts, let alone in a goddess of a mother cult. Though it was very widespread and reached both southern, southeastern parts of Europe and including ancient India. Similar made clay ceramic figures of mother goddesses were found in excavations in Mohenjo-Daro in India, located along the Indus River in present-day India, Pakistan. This would mean that women wore modern clothing at least, in a sense, 7,500 years ago. There's an important movement that, or direction we can see, we can appear, that the migrations leading to the pyramids. Some of the oldest, like step pyramid, ziggurat, is in Iran, and then Mesopotamia, and then into Egypt, seeming to show a direction movement. Or at least possibly. Also, the Kurgans their mound burial graves, they seem to start near the Altai region about 7,000 years ago, and then move steadily west into the Balkans and Ukraine and whatever. That also is interesting how there's a real connection with the dolmens and the distributions in both the Balkans and in even connections all the way to India. The Kirsch tablet is a limestone tablet found at Tel al-Hamur in Iraq, and is a site of an ancient Sumerian city of Kish. The Kish tablet is inscribed with proto-cuneiform signs and pictographic writing, and it's dated to around 5,500 years ago, made during the Yurk period. The emergence of partly symbolic writing, such as cuneiform and script, the proto-illiterate period of the Egyptians in Mesopotamia, is taken to span from about 5,500 years ago to 4,900 years ago. The first administrative texts dating to 5,100 years ago found in Jabdet, Nisr, and Tel Upkar represent further stage in development of proto-cruciform to cruciform. There could be also possible connections with other areas. During the proto-Elamite period, which is 5,300 years ago to 4,800 years ago, a political and economic harmony seems to have arisen in southwestern highlands of Iran, drive its control over major trade routes and the Iranian plateau and Mesopotamia. And it shares styles in ceramics, art, and architecture used in those other areas, and distinctive systems of writing and recording things. This reconstruction is supported by independent evidence that exploited materials at Farkar Haba, a city in the northern India, and obviously outside the proto-Elamite sphere of influence, such as in the lowlands of western Iran, emphasizing the role of long-distance trade, as always, can play in the rise or decline of prehistoric complex societies. Proto-Elamite harmony was a political and social phenomenon, but it was based on exploitation of an economic situation. The important factor has not changed in the mode of production or control over the means of production, such as the available land and natural resources, but instead it is a control over the ability and access to trade. Another is the Alphic tablet, an Arcanian administrative and legal text, partly of routine administrative documents, recording quantities of some commodities like cattle, wool, grain, precious metals. Tel Afik dates to the early 3rd millennium and early Bronze Age, and Apek at the beginning of the Middle Bronze Age during the reign of the Egyptian 12th Dynasty, a royal palace, in a sense, was put there. A rich cemetery also. Apek in the late Bronze Age is a Canaanite, or is listed as Canaanite Apek of Joshua. 1218 is mentioned again in Egyptian documents of the New Kingdom. It is into the city, confirmed the northern parts of the mound, that dictates these lines. During the initial phase of excavations, the late Bronze Age, Alphic, Arcadian, Sumerian, Canaanite, Hittite, and Egyptian documents have been unearthed, most of them coming from tall, fortified public building, which have been called the government houses. The extents of such diverse, complex inscriptions, many of them unique in Israel, points to an importance of Canaanite Ephek as a city situated in one of the main crossroads of the ancient Near East, a meeting point of cultures and languages. So the areas that are likely in the Cossacks and in some parts of Iran may connect to, in a sense, the Gravettian derived cultures by about 10,000 years ago to 8,000 years ago. Agriculture, cattle herding and other things, pottery, were derived in the Near East at this period, And these technologies arrived, you know, from Turkey. And though this region, in a sense, in general, we're already lightly inhabited, it doesn't seem like these new people that came in were doing it as war, just more like transferring ideas and peacefully entering in migration. So it starts with the Near East and Turkey, Iran, and Iraq, somewhere around there, and could even be parts of Israel, Jordan, Lebanon. Those areas, in a sense, go into Turkey. And by 9,000, 8,000 years ago, they're in the Balkans and so on. So there's the oldest, in a sense, outside of Turkey in Greece itself is about 8,251 years ago. So there's a lot of pottery cultures that can be tracked in this area from 7,000 to 6,500 years ago. And it can be done in genetics, seeing how the relation of the cultures are to each other. Historically, about 5,000 years ago, in large city-state societies such as Egypt and Iraq, culminated to make religion into something kind of new, a social-cultural government religious monarchy, where all, or at least many of the people of such large city-state societies seem familiar with and committed to the existence of religion as an integrated part of identity package and control dynamics with a fixed magical doctrine. However, this juggernaut integrated religion identity package of dogmatic propaganda certainly did not exist all at once, and it developed to an extent over time. It was highly limited in most smaller prehistoric societies, as they seem to lack most of the strong control dynamics with the fixed closed magical doctrines. These magical beliefs could be at times added and removed, and many people just wanted to see this development everywhere in the religious dynamics. Even if it is not. Instead, all that is found is largely fragments until the domestication of religion around 5,000 years ago. Religions, as we think of them today, are rarely a new fad, even if they go back to at least close to 6,000 years ago. This amount is almost nothing when seen as the long, slow evolution of religion that for humans at least started with the first worship 70,000 years ago, the oldest ritual worship of a stone snake in South Africa. This message of how religion and gods are intertwined with human is clearly a man-made idea that was developed slowly and was invented, reinvented, re-implemented piece by piece, which discredits all religious claims of truth. This seems to be a simple point which some are just not grasping, not understanding how devastating this is to any claims of truth. When we can see the lie clearly at archaeological sites showing religious evolution. Understanding religion evolution, I will sum it up again, is animism around 100,000 years ago, totemism around 50,000 years ago, shamanism around 30,000 years ago, paganism around 12,000 years ago, and then progressed organized religion, still paganism, around 5,000 years ago. So it went out in waves in this dispersal of farming into Europe. And it can be seen as adapting, morphing, changing a little bit as it went, still keeping some of the main elements of this original Neolithic paganism. So it's all about, to me, understanding these goddess figures that certainly start in the ordination period from sometime around 47,000 years ago until 30,000 years ago. Then there's a larger amount of goddesses produced or Venus figures, I should say, produced in the Gravettian culture from about 33,000 years ago till about 14,000 years ago, somewhere around there. And then you have the Magdalenian culture, which also produces these Venus figures, but more stylized. And to me, the first time we really see them sitting, or possibly depicted as sitting, or in that sort of a angle. And I think that as a connection to the later, or possibly a connection to the later goddess phenomenon that seems to be heavy into women sitting on thrones. So there's a representation at 17,000 years old in France, and I think it could be a representation of a totemistic sort of a reincarnation scene at Luxor Cave in southwest France. And it depicts a man with a bird head and next to a bison that could be charging him. And the phallus symbol on the man appears to be the same as the bullhorn. There's also an arrow shooting through the bull to the ground and ricocheting to a bird, like a stork. I think this is representing the connection or cycle of life. And so it makes me wonder, could in a sense this connect to the phallus phenomenon of a bullhorn and the shamanism phenomenon beginning at least 30,000 years ago? A phallic representation in the middle Magdalen period of 14,000 years ago is possibly one of a few projectile points that together with other similar ones might reference the meaning for the carving. As it, in a sense, could be that it's a surreal understanding of survival or life. And there's a piece that looks like a bear's head and has a double phallus. The Magdalenian refers to culture that was in Western Europe at least 17,000 to 12,000 years ago. And it was actually the ancestors, in a sense, of the Organation people that had been, in a sense, pushed into North Africa, probably, from the Gravettians, and then to later emerge back from North Africa into Europe again. The culture was geographically widespread. The later Magdalenian sites have been found from Portugal in the west to Poland in the east. Most remarkable evidence is from the prehistoric art that's found. There's a number of bones of red reindeer antlers and animal teeth that are found, crude pictures carved and etched in walls with pictures of seals, fish, reindeer, mammoths, and other creatures. Phallic decoration became prevalent among men of the Magdalenian culture in France and Spain around 12,000 years ago. Analysis of the mostly handheld art excavated from such sites in France, Spain, Germany, and Ukraine show that most of it was created in Europe approximately 30 to 40,000 years ago. Early sitting Venus. Venus of Colbert, 15,000 years ago from France, made of red quartzite, red being a sacred believed color, and also could connect to, it's a Venus figurine, it could connect to fertility, since red could be like menstruation blood, or in the birth of a baby. With some of the other figures in the cave's artifacts, including bone needles, even at the time having bone whistles. And I think this whistles or flutes or whatever could connect to religion as well. Especially this kind of a paganism shaman, type of religion. One cave had a bone pipe, and I think also pipe smoking or the belief in that can connect to shamanism. And it's still seen in cultures in the Andes doing this and other cultures using smoking. Even in the fire or smoking can be even seen in Australia. So all parts of this Venus of the Magdalenian date seem to have a stylized abstraction. So to me, it's not representing direct woman. It's directing the idea of a woman, almost like to me, like a metaphorical woman to me. And thus, right at the emergence before, to me, the idea of goddess. Years ago in Turkey is found the Yufa man, a statue that expresses with an expressionless face without a mouth. It's about 6.5 feet tall, like a totem pole, and it's made of stone, and it's holding what looks like it could be his own genitals, which it also could connect to the phallus phenomenon. And I think that the issue is, I think that in a sense, generally, they have men as the clan leaders, in a sense, and then females, I believe, were the ones more in charge of religion. And so this also though, could connect, this figure could connect to fertility. And it does have a pronounced necklace with two chevron triangles, which could represent some sort of authority or ritualistic symbolism, all of which, in a sense, is made with limestone, except for the eyes, which have been carved out, and then pieces of obsidian have been put in their place. So there is what could represent, right, a clan leader or a special male ancestor totem pole. And I think it also possibly could connect to this, before it, phallus phenomenon. The Han Dynasty has a double phallus representation of China that's about 12,000 years old. And the first known indication of homosexual and bisexual practices among human beings goes back to prehistory of at least 12,000 years ago also. Some cave paintings seem to be homoerotic, and among other devices used by humans were these phallic-shaped objects. The most interesting object was characterized with the so-called double phallus found in France. It seems to be possibly what could be conceived as a sex toy. Or maybe the double part of it being two horns of a bull. As before I said, there is a picture that seems to reference the male phallus or penis as being associated with a bull's horn. So having a double penis or double phallus object could actually just be horns. And I think also there's an understanding that horns are considered to be like stars, like the sky. In other words, like there's a star animals that because they have horns. The results of the Neolithic revolution was permanent establishments were made. Neolithic villages continued to divide work between this new thing of men and women. And women's status thus declined as men, in a sense, were forced allowed to take a lead in most of these areas of society. Paganism begins about 12,000 years ago to me, as seen such sites in Turkey. And hologroup G.A. and the seemingly development of early agriculture, hologroup G, descends from microhologroup F, which is thought to represent the second migration of Homo sapiens out of Africa at least 60,000 years ago. Hologroup G has 303 mutations, confirming a severe bottleneck before slipping into hologroup G1 and G2. G1 might have originated around modern-day Iran 26,000 years ago. G2 would have developed around the same time in Western Asia, and hologroup G2 appears to have been closely linked with the development of early agriculture under Fertile Crescent around 11,500 years ago. G2A branch expanded to Anatolia, Turkey, the Cossacks, and Europe, while G2B diffused from Iran across the Fertile Crescent and east to Pakistan. There has so far been ancient Y-DNA analysis from early Neolithic Anatolia, Turkey, Iran, Israel, Jordan, as well as the Neolithic cultures in Europe, Thessalonian, Neolithic in Greece, the Star-Hurvo culture in Hungary and Croatia, the LBM, the Linear Black Pottery culture in Germany, and the Ramadero culture in Italy, and the cardamom pottery in southwest France and Spain. And all sites yield a majority of G2A individuals, except from the Levant. This strongly suggests that farming was domesticated and disseminated by members of hologroup G, at least from Turkey and Iran, then moved to Europe. 44 ancient Near Eastern samples, including that of Neolithic farmers from Jordan and Western Iran, have been found with G2B samples dating from the pre-pottery Neolithic around 9,250 years ago and G2A1 from the early pottery Neolithic 7,700 years ago, both from Iran. The highest genetic diversity within hologroup G is found in the northern parts of the Fertile Crescent, between the Levant and the Cossacks, which is a good indicator of its origin. Catal hook in south central Turkey was founded by farmers who brought domesticated goats and sheep. Also around 8,500 500 years ago, G2A Neolithic farmers arrived in northwest Anatolia and Thessaly in central Greece, and are attested by ancient genomes around that time that seem to also bring cattle domestication, introduced to Catal, Huyuk, and other sites in central Turkey, presumably by trading with their eastern neighbors. Ancient skeletons from the Starcervo Crusoe Chris culture from 8,000 to 6,500 years ago in Hungary and Croatia, and the linear pottery culture 7,500 to 6,500 years ago in Hungary and Germany, all confirm that G2A, both G2A 2A and G2A B, remain the principal paternal lineage even after farmers had immigrated with the indigenous populations. G2A farmers from the Thessalonian Neolithic quickly expanded across the Balkans and the Danube Basin, reaching Serbia, Hungary, Romania by 7,800 years ago, Germany by 7,500 years ago, Belgium and northern France by 7,200 years ago. By 7,800 years ago, farmers making, in a sense, cortal pottery arrive at the coast of northwest Anatolia with pigs. These people crossed the Aegean by boat and colonized the Italian peninsula, the Iberian coast, southern France, Iberia, were established with this cordum pottery culture between 7,000 years ago and 3,500 years ago. Once again, ancient DNA yields a majority of G2A samples in the cardamom pottery culture, with G2A frequencies above 80%, against 50% in the central and southern Eastern Europe. Nevertheless, substantial minorities of other hologroups have been found on different Neolithic sites next to a G2A majority, including C1A2, H2I, I2A1, I2C, and J2A in Turkey. C1A2E M78, H2I, I1, I2A, I2A1, J2, and T1A in southeastern and central Europe. So, 12,000 years ago, Jericho has evidence of settlement. Jericho was a popular camping ground for Nufian hunter-gatherers, who left a scattering of crescent microlith tools behind. 12,000 years ago is the earliest suggested dates for the domestication of the goat. 11,600 years ago is the current Holocene epoch. 11,000 to 13,000 years ago is the earliest recorded dates, in a sense, for Gobekli Tepe and Turkey. 11,000 years ago is the emergence of Jericho, which is now one of the oldest continually inhabited cities around the world. Giant short-faced bears and giant ground sloths go extinct in North America. 10,500 years ago, earliest supposed date for the domestication of cattle. 10,000 years ago is a event, extinction event. And 11,900 years ago, Babylos appears to be settled during the period of the pre-pottery Neolithic B. Neolithic remains in some building sites have been observed. 10,800 years ago, the post-glacial sea rises, slowing the submersion of land taken by place by about 10,000 years ago. 10,000 years ago to 9,000 years ago, in northern Mesopotamia, what is now Iraq, cultivation of barley and wheat begins. At first, they are believed to be used for beer, for gruel, for soup, eventually for bread. In early agriculture at this time, the planting stick is used, but it's replaced by a primitive type of plow in subsequent cultures. Around this time, a round stone tower is built in Jericho. 9,500 years ago to 5,900 years ago, there's a Neolithic in North Africa. The Sahara Desert region supports a savanna-like environment. Lake Chad is bigger than the current Caspian Sea, and African culture develops across the region. 9,500 years ago, Catal, Huyuk, urban settlement is founded in Turkey, and is for some believed the earliest domestication of the cat. 9,200 years ago, first settlements in Jordan. 9,000 years ago, the Xiongnu culture begins in China. 9,000 years ago, the first fish fermentation is seen in Sweden. 8,200 years ago is the K2 kilometer event, a sudden decrease in global temperatures likely caused the final collapse of the ice sheets and led to a drier conditions in East Africa and Mesopotamia. 8,000 to 5,000 years ago, the development of proto-writing in China, Southeast Europe with the Vinic civils, and Western Asia with the proto-illiterate cuneiform. 8,000 years ago, evidence for habitations of sites such as Aleppo and Tel Carmel. However, evidence for this settlement is larger. Copper smelting is 7,500 years ago. Evidence in several locations. 7,200 to 6,000 years ago is first farming settlements on the island of Malta. 12,000 years ago, approximately. There's also a possible clan leader or special male ancestor totem poles, as well as a totem pole that includes what looks like a woman giving birth surrounded by snakes. The Sinclair sculpture, or Sinclair idol, the oldest wooden sculpture in the world, is made during this period shortly after the Ice Age. The wood is carved in approximately 11,500 years ago, and it's about buried in a depth of 13 foot of peat bog. Why it even survived. And it has geometrical motifs and decorated on its surface, including things like zigzag lines depicting a human face and hands, horizontal lines, it may be representing ribs, and has lines broken into chevrons that cover the rest of its described body. However, on the face and top of several faces on it is visible at various points along the sculpture. I believe it's a clan totem pole. It resembles what looks like almost an older version of a totem pole. Scholars have proposed various ideas about the carvings and the meanings. Other researchers have suggested that the markings could be some kind of a map. And could be they depict also mythological creatures and such things as maybe forest spirits. And an interesting side note is that there's similar face decoration to the oldest known stone monuments at Gobekli Tepe, Turkey. So 11,000 years ago, the Fertile Crescent and some parts of southern Turkey begin agriculture, and then it spreads out from there. And it's a concession of not one set of people, but like I said, many waves of migration. And also of note is the fact of the regional distribution, it seems, especially after 12,000, of the what people call Venuses or mother goddesses. And the 11,500 year old one from Israel is sitting, in a sense, goddess figurine. And I think that, and there's a bunch of ones that involve sitting at various other regions. And the similarities among these, you know, prehistoric figurines, going from Sardinia all the way to the, you know, Indus Valley in India or Pakistan. And they seem to have a similar kind of recurring theme of, you know, being overweight, and especially the fleshy parts of their thighs and buttocks. And they're in a seated posture. They're female, and they appear to have breasts. Although one interesting feature is they really don't appear to have heads. I think one of the reasons they don't have heads, like the skull coat focusing on heads, is because I think without a head, in a sense, it's more anthropomorphic and less directly perceived as an ancestor human. There's also possible clan leader or special male ancestor totems with similar faces to the figure from Russia and that's 11,500 years ago, the Sinclair idol, and also Gobekli Tepe, that's 12,000 years ago, at Nivikori, a site in Turkey around 10,400 years ago to 10,100 years ago. And also at that same site, there is a megalithic temple and it's about 10,400 years old. And an interesting note to possible advanced society at this time, there's a cave painting in Iran that's about 11,000 to 10,000 years old, and it seems to show evidence of someone riding a horse, like horseback, and may even appear to have some kind of a reins or something. And I think this is interesting to the end that it's showing the ability to transport, you know, things. Because, I mean, people transporting people on horses is a lot easier than walking. And then just think of also if the horses were used to, you know, pull things, even at this or some early, you know, time, you can see how the transportation of civilization and distribution of, you know, also religion would be a lot easier and would have a longer reach. And there is evidence of how early agricultural communities thrived in Iran around this time of 11,000 to, like I said, 10,000 years ago, and maybe even 12,000 years ago in Iran. And to that end, in a sense, their sites do seem to have a unique provenance. But by around 7,000 years ago, a period which corresponds with some of the cemeteries, a once tiny village at this time was transformed and evolved into expansive urban area that paved the way for the later civilizations in the area. Bladed tools that are found in southwest Iran, which date to around 10,000 years ago, were made from obsidian that was transported from Turkey. Around 10,000 years ago, settlements in Nevekori in Turkey were established. Around 10,000 years ago, Esiki Huyuk was formed in Turkey. Cappadocia in central Turkey was also established around this time. Around 10,000 years ago, settlements at Sigalos in southwest Turkey are also established. Around 9,500 years ago is the establishment of Catal. A very large Neolithic and Catalithic settlement in south Turkey is founded. Around 9,200 years ago, Kanuyu in southeast Turkey is formed. The likely domestication site for emmer wheat and the first domestication of cattle and pigs. So I think this is time to get back to the goddesses. And the sitting goddess from Shahar Hagron, a 10,000-year-old figure from Israel, and a Neolithic stylized figures in agricultural civilizations are similar in the region. This Neolithic site that it was found at is important and one of the largest in Israel. The Venus is made of clay and resembles being put together in several parts. The sitting goddess, to me, phenomenon has started. The first, in a sense, what I think for sure is a goddess on a throne, comes from that first religious, you know, city, created city, you know, Catal Huyuk of 9,500 years ago from south central Turkey. And to me, it's a possible proto-sable goddess known as the Great Mother or the Mountain Mother that is later seen in all over, including places like Greece, Spain, Italy. Two different styles from this early settlement. The figure seated on the throne clearly defines her as a goddess, while the more stick figure like statuettes evolving styles are seen to be more abstract. Might be the difference between giving birth and living. It is not unusual to see a mix of styles within cultural artifacts. There are other figurines found at the site that are painted in the Hafa style. Female figurines are found at all levels of the site, and they increase at level 6, the number, and become more finely modeled. Another figure then was made in fired clay, and the lion-headed goddesses of West Asia. I think the chair that the oldest figurine is sitting on or throne is in a sense has a lion or some sort of a cat on each side. And the goddesses on a lion throne is abundantly attested in archaeological sites in Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Canaan, Israel. First, we'll look at the Phoenician scarab showing lions' thrones as often with wings. And then actual stone thrones in ancient Lebanon, Canaanite inventories with winged sphinxes, and also Asherah enthroned with winged lionesses. This led to, in a sense, a commenting on some of the biblical parallels that are found in these goddesses. The Bible I'm talking about connects to some of these goddesses. And we look at some of the goddesses and the Aunt Nolan, in the sense throne goddesses, have a connection. So Catal Huyuk is the first, in a sense, religious design cities. Most homes, in a sense, had their own temple in their house. And most of the buildings seem to be somewhat communal. Anyways, it's about 9,500 years ago to 7,700 years old. There is a sitting goddess from Halciar that's 9,000 years old from southwestern Turkey, called by many a mother goddess made of clay. It has been noted that it's a continuation at Halciar of goddess figurine tradition, advanced westward from Catal Huyuk. This figure also is a variance on the sitting goddess position. Halciar also has a 7,500 to 8,000-year-old unbaked clay female figure called the Mistress of Animals, clutching what looks to be or is believed to be a leopard cub, and she is seated on a leopard. And the Halciar is the Turkey area of importance as an archaeological site with significant artifacts at the site displayed even at the area for civilization of Turkey in general. And then you have the sitting Venuses or goddesses of the Vincia culture. And they were figurines were found, were often seemingly young women, beautifully dressed. And their bracelets and things were on the arm and seemed to have decorative clothing, maybe religious clothing. The Vincia culture dated between 7,400 and 6,700 years ago. And basically 300, found some of these were found at a 300 acre site and seemed to be expressing trade, handcrafts, and metallurgy along with their art. And findings suggest an advanced diffusion of labor, organization, and the dead were buried in tidy necropolis. Sitting goddesses from Haffa, 7,000 years ago in northern Syria border of Mesopotamia. And there's a few styles of these seated goddesses. The majority are painted in a striped fashion. A theory of why their seated posture has been explained in relation to possible childbirth, which to me is likely, you know, sacred. And ultimately, it could connect to the Mesopotamian goddess traditions and attributes of Ayana seated on her throne, which does occur in many other figurines. The sitting goddesses of the prehistoric religion of ancient Malta. Some of the figures have been found in Western Europe, but with yields have been much richer in sites like Egypt, the Levant, Turkey, Greece, Cyprus, and the Balkans. And some of the most early elaborate figures coming from the island of Malta. In several images, human figures display an important role, and these seemingly fat ladies are associated with the celebration of fertility, both human and agricultural. In the Balkans, such figures were kept in houses, inside, especially constructed niches, sometimes in the walls. In Turkey, at the site of Catal, the fine figurines of clay and stone were associated with burials of high-status people in special shrines, whereas cruder figures were found in houses. Some of the figures were even found in grain bins. During the time of agriculture became widely practiced in the Fertile Crescent. Discovery of similar figurines at far-flung sites and from desperate areas apart from each other, show a long tradition of widespread prehistoric pagan religion based on the worship of mother goddesses. For example, some archaeologists have tried to show that the cult of the eye goddess called because of the eye motifs in Mesopotamian idols, diffuses through the entire Mediterranean. More recently, claims have been made that the Balkans were part of the central of old European religion. Most modern scholars appreciate that the early cults were, in a sense, radically different in each prehistoric society, and that the cults of the domestication life were distinct from cults of the sense of death and the burial. The example of Malta demonstrated variation most easily. Everywhere else in the Mediterranean, the cults generally evolved simple domestic rituals. Little effort was invested in religious art itself, or in religious architecture. In Malta, however, the worship of images generally blossomed into a culminating passion that that may have been the roots, in a sense, for these conditions and labeled as closed, isolated, introverted societies to develop. Today, the dry, rocky hillsides of the island of Malta gave rise to the farming communities. Little soil vegetation is present, and obtaining fresh water is a problem. Yet, the geographic evidence suggests that between 7,000 years ago to 5,000 years ago, a far more innervating set of inhabitants must have come there. There may have been up to 7,000 individuals that have been buried in 32 chambers of a complex of religion burial on Malta. They had been interned along with grave gifts of pots, obsidian and flint tools, jewelry consisting of beads and stone pendants, and clay and stone figures of obese women generally, and animals. One of the striking figures was that of a sleeping lady. This statuette shows a rounded female lying on her side in an elaborately woven bed. She seems clothed, garnered in skirts, and her hair is dressed in a small, neat bun. About 7,000 years ago, most burials in Egypt have a female figure that's naked placed in the grave. I believe this could be the beginning of the Egyptian goddess Nut. Nut, ancient Egyptian, also known by various other names or translation, is the goddess of the sky in ancient Egypt religion. She was a star covered nude woman arching over the earth, or as a cow. The sky goddess Nut was or has been depicted as a cow, and is a direct contrast to most other mythologies, which usually develop the sky father associated with the earth mother, or mother nature. She personified the sky, and the male personified the earth. This ancient Egyptian term, in a sense, is hard to understand the punctuation, because vowels were long omitted from its writing. And although her name often includes the unpronounceable hieroglyph for sky, her name itself, also meaning sky, usually transcribed as Nut, also sometimes appears in older sources as Nunut, Ninut, Naunt, and Nut. She is considered one of the oldest deities among the Egyptian pantheon, with her origin being founded on the creation story of Hierapolis. She was originally the goddess of the nighttime sky, but eventually became referred simply as a sky goddess. Her headdress was hieroglyphic part of her name, a pot which symbolized a uterus. Most depicted in form of nude human form, Nut was sometimes depicted in the form of a cow whose great body formed the sky and the heavens. A circus tree, or a giant sow pig, suckling many piglets, representing the many stars. It can be said that she was a version of the great goddess Hathor. Like Hathor, she not only had death and rebirth associations, but was the protector of children and the goddess of childbirth. Part of the sitting goddess phenomenon. There's a figure that's sitting holding a child. This figure is a woman in clay sitting on a stool with an infant in her arms. And it's from Thessaly and it is dated to 6,800 years ago to 6,500 years ago. This figure depicts a mother, like I said, which it appears to be she's preparing to nurse and doing it possibly with what looks like, you know, sensitivity and tenderness. I think this can associate with the sitting goddess is mothering. So, a map of early Neolithic Europe shows the diffusion of all these cultures and the shared connections they have. After the last ice age, most of Europe has I-1 or I-2. Old Europe, cardamom culture in Western Europe had I-1 and I-2. The dominant, in a sense, which Neolithic farmers with their J2, E1, and G added to. So the oldest bronze items were discovered, in a sense, with the Vedic area and were associated with I2, A1, and their highest concentrations. I2, A1... is also very high in the area of Sardinia, and the highest A1A in connections with Bosnia and south of Croatia in Serbia. Here's another map that shows the diffusion of genes into those early cultures. Then we have the Butmer culture, and it is from the Neolithic period and is dated to 7,100 to 6,500 years ago. It was part of the larger Danube civilization characteristics. So there is a resemblance between styles of Minoan pottery, and it may suggest a connection to the Minoan culture on Crete. Of course, this was during the same time that some have suggested that Troy was founded. An overwhelming modern opinion is the Butmer people were a unique culture in their own in the Sarajevo area, though it probably is connected, an offshoot branch. It depicts, in the figurine, it depicts a cart with three wheels and being pulled in a sense by ducks with a female anthropomorphic duck-headed woman goddess riding it. So there was a real transfer all over from Turkey out into Europe and some parts of the Middle East. The genealogy of the Sumerian Arcanian gods lists the first god by herself, a mother goddess, Namenu. At least 5,000 to 6,000 years ago or older, a Sumerian mythology, Namu, was a primordial goddess, is also associated with magic, and corresponds to Tiamat in Babylonian mythology. Very little is known about this goddess, who belongs to the oldest, in a sense, generation of Mesopotamian deities, and is associated with the pantheon of Eridu. She is mainly known for her role in cosmology in the early Mesopotamia and her importance in magic specifically, which is restricted to texts written in Sumerian. According to the god list of An and Arum, tablet 1, line 28, Nama bears the title of mother who gave birth to the heavens and the earth. Namu is a goddess of the sea that gave birth to An, the heaven, and Ki, the earth, and the first gods, representing the freshwater ocean that the Sumerians believed lay beneath the earth, the source of life-giving water and fertility in a country with almost none to little rainfall. Namu is not well attested in Sumerian mythology. She may have been of greater importance in prehistoric times, before Ink took the most of her functions. An indication of her continued relevance may be found in a name of Ur-Nammu, the founder of the third dynasty of Ur. According with Neo-Sumerian mythological text, Inki and Namur, Inki, a son of An and Namu. Namu is the goddess who gave birth to the great gods. It is she who has said to have the idea of created mankind, and she who goes to wake up Inki, who is asleep, and who has to start the progression going. And Namu told him to help her son Inki. She created humans in the image of most interesting Namu as the only female prime mover in cosmological myths in antiquity. Namu is called the original mother who gave birth to the gods in the universe. According to her primary status among all the gods, described her role in Mesopotamian cosmology. Later on, particular in Archean texts, Nama loses importance and is only relatively mentioned. Aside from a few mentions, Nama and other mythological and literary texts about other gods, no mythology in this ancient goddess in a sense has survived in the current ages. The Sumerian goddess Mamu. To me, there's a depiction that looks like a goddess figure standing and holding a baby with a, it could be a snake head. The Sumerian Venus figures, 4,300 to 3,800 years ago from Mesopotamia. The figurine of Anna seated on her throne. She was the goddess who granted kingship. And other figures from Ur. These would be representations of Anna as a very, in a sense, popular goddess. The hands on the breasts often of the dead give away the Venus figure. It is one that indications a statue of a great mother of the earth. And in this posture of sitting became a standard across many cultures from as early as 12,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, somewhere on there. So there's an Egyptian goddess, who's in a sense sitting on a throne with Sphinx and a scepter, and she looks very similar to these other sitting goddesses. There's a drawing of that's almost exactly the same as the one from Egypt, but it's from Sicily, and it can show there may have connections with the Phoenician finds, exhibiting in a sense a strong Egyptian influence. And the goddess holds a lotus scepter, often seen attributed with Kismic goddesses. And there's also a scarab, like plaque thing from Lebanon, which also has winged sun and star of Ashtar, planet Venus, and a sitting on a throne with, you know, sphinxes or, you know, lions with wings. And it also is similar to one seen in Phoenician scarabs, showing that there's a connected continuity with these different tradition and goddess beliefs. Hathor was a major goddess in ancient Egypt religion who played a wide variety of roles as a sky deity. There also has been depicted sitting with a child. And as a sky deity, she was a mother or consort of the sky of Horus and the sun god Ra, both of whom were connected with kingship, and thus she was a symbolic mother of their early representatives, the pharaohs. She was one of several goddesses who acted as the eye of Ra, or Ra's feminine side or counterpart. And this form, she was vengeful and aspects also of protection from his enemies. Her beneficial side represented things like music, dance, joy, love, sexuality, and maternal care. And she was, in a sense, a cohort of several male deities, as well as supposed mother to several of their sons. These two sides of the goddess exemplified in the Egyptian conception of femininity. Hathor crossed boundaries between believed both worlds, helping deceased souls in a transition to the afterlife. Hathor was depicted as a cow, symbolizing her material and celestial aspects, although her most common form was a woman wearing a headdress of a cow, horns, and a sun disc. She could also be represented as a lioness, or as a snake, such as a cobra, or even a tree. Showing that all these concepts that are connected to each other in goddesses. Cattle goddesses, similar to Hathor, were portrayed in Egyptian art in the 4th millennium or 6,000 years ago. But she herself may not have appeared until the Old Kingdom, somewhere around 4,686 years ago. With the patronage of the Old Kingdom rulers, she became one of Egypt's most important deities. More temples were dedicated to her than any other goddess, of which most prominent temple was in Upper Egypt. So there's a real distribution of goddess that seem to connect from the beginning almost of the distribution of goddesses and till its full emergence. And now let's talk about the goddess Isis, who is in a sense seen nursing, almost similar to the Hathor figure. And she's Isis is seen, you know, nursing Horus, and it dates to around 2,700 years ago. Isis is treated as the mother of Horus, even in the earliest copies of the pyramid texts. Isis is also known for her magical powers. Similar to other sky goddesses, many of the roles Isis required gave her an important position in the sky. Passages in the pyramid texts connect Isis closely with Soptit, the goddess representing the star of Cyrus, whose relationship with her husband in the constellation of Orion. Seeming evidence of this universal goddess phenomenon in Ptolemaic times, Isis' sphere of influence could include entire cosmos. As the deity that protected Egypt and supposedly endorsed its kings, she had power over thus all nations, and power over the rain and the natural world itself. There are hymns that call her the ruler of the sky, and says she goes out and expands her authority. So it is a climax of her domination encompassing the sky, earth. It is said that her powers over nature nourishes humans, the blessed dead, and the gods. Other Greek language hymns call her the beautiful essence of all the gods. In the course of Egyptian history, many deities, major and minor, have been described in similar terms, possibly showing this universal connection. So 6,000 years ago to 7,000 years ago, there's the emergence of kurgans, which are burial mounds. And along with 7,000-year-old dolmens, or funeral ritual and other, journey to the stunned stars, heavenly symbols to the stars, or just symbols of the heavens in general, or the place to reach the heavens, and possibly connects to ancestors as seen in shamanism and rock art of Siberia and Central Asia. Makes me wonder, not only is there a connection between dolmens and kurgans, but could there also be a connection to them and the ziggurats and pyramids? Experts now believe that the megaliths stood at the very heart of ritual practice for networking communities scattered across Western Europe and later into the Stone Age or Neolithic period, and that they had begun around 12,000 years ago. Their function was both earthly and celestial, a focus on rites concerning the movement of what are believed to be heavenly bodies across the sky, and a memorial to communicate with the community's ancestors, a way of knowing the seasons, and just to create awe-inspiring sights. Dolmens, generally single-chamber ritual megaliths, date from around 7,000 to 6,000 years ago, likely emerging in Brittany, northern France. Kurgans, in a sense, burial mounds over a burial chamber, are around 7,000 to 6,000 years ago, likely emerging from Siberia or the Cossacks, and certainly by the Cossacks dated by 6,000 years ago. Except it seems there have been pre-Kurgan mounds in Siberia in the Novosibirsk region dating to around 7,000 years ago. Ziggurats, multi-platform temples date to around 4,900 years ago, and seeing the emergence of Tel al-Urbud is a typical site as a early dynastic temple. Pyramids are, in a sense, multi-platformed or mountain-like tombs dating to around 4,700 years ago, likely emerged from Gris el-Mur or Sabrakur, only several hundred feet west of the Step Pyramid and the Buried Pyramid. Dolmens are a single chamber ritual megalith around 7,000 to 6,000 years ago. And astronomers have been exploring what might be described as the first astronomical observation tool, which a dolmen would be in some context. And potentially this used by historic, humans around 6,000 years ago in Portugal. They suggest that a long, narrow entrance passage to these ancient stone or megalith tombs may have actually enhanced early human culture, allowing them to see into the sky to a certain point. The effect that could be interpreted as our ancestors gaining this special power, and also could be connecting to possibly not just looking at the stars, but the belief that the person being buried, in a sense, is being launched or aimed at the stars. And they suggest to me that they could have had this connection to the later belief in stars, like as an astrology, having constellations representing even human births. Dolmens used in this way seem like the features found in some of the pyramids, aiming to the stars, that could have been thought to actually be ancestors above. The place where they go, it is possible to reason to think that these ghosts of life in the skies or stars could relate to things like the later zodiac, could also relate in some way to sky burial theory in general, as possible origins at least 12,000 to 30,000 years ago. Dolmens reached Britain, Ireland, and southern Scandinavia about 6,000 years ago. Sites in Central and Southern Europe are constructed at similar date. There are generally all regarded as tombs or burial chambers, despite the absence of clear evidence of always being a burial. Human remains, sometimes accompanied by artifacts, have been found in or close to dolmens, which could signify using ideas that they were connected to the graves. Human remains, though, are not always found. It is, in a sense, impossible to prove that these remains are connected to the stones or at the same time that they were placed. A dolmen is a type of single chamber megalith, usually constructed with two or more vertical megalith stones supporting a flat horizontal stone like a table. Kurgans, in a sense, burial mounds over, in a sense, a burial chamber, 7,000 to 6,000 years ago. Likely, like I said, emerging first in Siberia and then in the Cossacks. I think they could have some religious thinking transfer to things like the pyramids, and maybe even things like the ziggurats, the multi-platform temples. Ziggurats were huge, in a sense, religious monuments built by the ancient Mesopotamian Valley and the West Iranian Plateau. Having the form of terrace step pyramid, successively other stories and levels above them, there are 32 ziggurats known at or in near Mesopotamia. 28 of them are in Iraq, and 4 of them are in Iran. Ziggurats were built by the Sumerians, the Babylonians, the Elamites, the Assyrians, as monuments to religion in their local regions. The probable precursors of the ziggurats and temples supported platform terrace date to the Huyuk period, about 6,000 years ago. The earliest ziggurats probably date to a later part of the early dynastic period of Sumer. Tepe stock ziggurat in Iran was built around 5,000 years ago, and the oldest settlement in stock date to around 8,000 years ago to 7,500 years ago. Ziggurats, the multi-platform temples around 4,900 years ago. Mesopotamia evolved, in a sense, their ideas around their gods, and so naturally the home of the gods, the ziggurats, on Earth are formed. The movement towards this urbanization began based upon the analysis of grave goods. As one increasingly polarized social stratification and the decreasing of the egalitarianism before, which has been described as a trans-egalitarian moreover, it has been hypothesized that the Ubid culture saw the rise of an elite class of hierarchy chieftains, perhaps heads of kin groups or clans, linked in some way to the administration of these early temple shrines. Like the Temple of Sumerian Mother Goddess, Nimhag, like the temple at Kaladhai, this too is surrounded by oval-shaped enclosure walls. Tel al-Ubud, a low small tell site, is a proposed Sumerian town lying on the Euphrates, about 4 miles northwest of the nearby city of Ur. The majority of the remains from the Ubid period, for which Tel al-Yub is the type of site, is early dynastic temples at the highest point. The early dynastic temple is located on the northern edge of the site. The temple of Nimhag, goddess of childbirth and divine protector of animals. Enshrined at a time when the Sumerian cities were nearing their height of power and influence, the temples featured 8 large copper-sheathed lions guarding the entrance. The inside of the structure were decorated with elegant reliefs inlaid in red limestone and mother of pearl, and the summit was a cleared oval similar to that of others. The wall surrounding the temple was built by your third emperor. Also found at Tel al-Yub was the lower levels of Tel held smaller houses made from reeds that dated from an earlier period with similar huts along with primitive pottery. The early diagnostic period of archaeological culture of Mesopotamia in southern Iraq, that is generally dated to around 4,900 years ago to 4,350 years ago, involving multiple city-states, small states with relatively simple structure that developed and solidified over time. It was the development ultimately led to a unification of much of Mesopotamia under the rule of Sargon, the first monarch of the Akkadian Empire. Despite the political fragmentation, such city-states shared a relatively homogeneous material and religious culture. The early dynastic period in Iraq generally is dated to 4,900 years ago. So let's get to pyramids. So pyramids are multi-platform tombs dated to around 4,700 years ago. Pyramids, like the pyramids of Djoser, a step pyramid, or a proto-pyramid with the levels on four sides. The step pyramid is the only pyramid in the Old Kingdom that 11 of the king's daughters were buried aside. The pyramid of Djoser was built for the burial of the pharaoh of Djoser, intended to hold his mummified body. There were the oldest type of Egyptian pyramids and were the precursors for the what we now consider the true pyramids, built with more smooth sides. It is the step pyramid who was, in a sense, considered to be inspired by a polymath, poet, judge, magician, scribe, astrologer, physician, high priest, counselor to the pharaoh of Djoser. The step pyramid complex was enclosed by a 30-foot wall that included courtyards, temples, chapel, covered nearly 40 acres, the size of a large town. And this was about around 5,000 years ago. As an earlier tombs of the step pyramid chambers are underground, hidden by a maze of tunnels, probably to discourage grave robbers. Now let's get to the pyramids of China. Pyramids of China are pyramidal-shaped tomb structures, I think also connect to Kurgans, in Inner Mongolia region of northern China. Chinese archaeologists have discovered pyramids which have dated to around or more than 5,000 years ago. Archaeologists have also suggested that a three-step pyramid belonging to the Hong San culture period of around 5,000 to 6,000 years ago during the Stone Age. It was atop of the pyramid the archaeologists found several tombs and the ruins of an altar. Interesting, because in a sense pyramids in Egypt are just relatively tombs, where ziggurats are relatively not tombs but actually like altars or places of worship. And so it's interesting that in China we see one at an older date acting as both, or possibly both. Also found were many fragments of broken carved pottery and Chinese characters. They discovered bone flutes and stone ring and a life-size sculpture of a goddess. The term Chinese pyramid refers to pyramidal structure shapes in China. Most ancient are burial mounds built to house the remains of several of the early emperors of China and their imperial relatives. Sounds almost like Egypt. About 38 of them are located northwest in Xin, Xinhai province. Most fragments are from the first Qin emperor. And it is west of where the terracotta warriors are found. The earliest tombs in China were found just north of Beijing in the Inner Mongolia Autonomous Region. They belong to the Neolithic Hansung culture and date to around 6,700 years ago to 2,900 years ago in northeastern China. The Hansung culture is known for its jade pig dragons and other dragons, clay figurines, including figurines of pregnant women, have also found throughout site. Small copper rings were excavated. Origin of the bronze in China indicate they contained lead with high things that connect to the Yellow River. And around 3,400 years ago, discoveries of an underground temple complex, which a hidden altar also containing charms. The temple was constructed of stone platforms and paneled walls. Archaeologists have named this the Goddess Temple due to discovery of clay female heads with jade inlaid eyes. It was an and since underground 1 meter deep, including on its walls mural paintings. Housed inside the Goddess Temple are clay figurines as large as three times the size of real life in a sense, or an average size humans. They are exceedingly large figurines and possibly deities. And they, but for the region, do not reflect any other Chinese culture. The existence and complex trading networks and monumental architecture, such as the pyramids and the Pyramid of the Goddess Temple, point to the existence of believed chieftains in these prehistoric communities. Painted pottery was also discovered within the temple. Over 60 nearby tombs have been unearthed, all constructed in stone and covered by stone mounds, frequently including jade artifacts. Entombed inside were sculptures also of dragons and tortoises. It has been suggested that religious sacrifice might have been performed within the Hansung culture in northeast China. Hansung culture was preceded by the Xinglonghua culture around and then, the Inixil culture and the Zahabowu culture, which may have been contemporary or a little later. The Yang Songhu culture was in the larger area contemporary with the Hang Song culture. These two cultures integrated with each other. Just seen and suggested by the evidence found at these cultural sites, provide the earliest evidence of what can be considered feng shui. The presence of both round and square shapes at the Hang Song cultural ceremonial centers suggests early presence in a sense of a kind of a cosmological round heaven and square earth ideas. The three exceptional pyramids considered to have three different methods. DNA analysis shows that 6,500 years ago, human remains from Israel point to origins of ancient culture connected to southern waves of migrants from Turkey, as well as a little bit from the Zagros Mountains of Iran. The Graciulian Star is a mysterious 6,000-year-old mural found in Jordan. Very, very close similarities to the Ishtar Ayana worship star from 6,000 years ago to 5,100 years ago, called the Star of Ishtar. So the question is that Graciulian star, the mysterious star from Jordan, a proto-star of Ishtar, star of Ayana, star of Venus? I believe they may be. And to me, thus possibly could be some kind of connection to this central Asian deity of Tan, the god of sky. May also be related to Tanjiri. Goddesses Ishtar and Ayana were worshipped in Sumer, at least as early as the Uruk period of 6,000 years ago to 5,100 years ago. Speaking about the people that created the mysterious star in Jordan, in a sense, this was made at a time before people were writing, in a sense, and everyone at the time was kind of more hunting and gathering and in small farming villages. The figurines there are painted with black and brown and red, white and yellow. In a sense, they are features, you know, that also seem to have a color relationship to the stars. Gastulin refers to a culture, archaeological stage during the middle and late copper period in southern Levant, anywhere from 6,400 years ago to 5,500 years ago. This type of site is located in eastern Jordan Valley near the north edge of the Dead Sea. The Glacian stage was characterized by small hamlets and settlements of mixed farming peoples who had immigrated north and settled in the southern Levant. Today, Jordan, Israel, Palestine, peoples of the Beersheba culture, a Glaciulian subculture, lived in underground dwellings, a unique phenomenon in the archaeological history of the region. Or they lived in houses that were trapezoidal shaped, built of mud bricks, were often built partially underground. and they had remarkable shapes paintings on the walls. The pottery was highly elaborate, including footed bowls that were horn-shaped and drinking goblets, indicating the civilization was also into drinking wine. Several samples display the use of clay covering and paint when it was still wet. The culture used stone tools. It also smelted copper. Funerary customs show evidence that they were buried the dead in stone dolmens, and also practiced secondary burial as seen in skull cults. Settlements belonging to the Glashun culture have been identified as numerous other sites in what is today southern Israel, especially in the region of Beersheba, where elaborate underground dwellings have been excavated. The Glashun culture correlates closely with the Armenian of Egypt, and also seems to identify distance of bird vessels as seen in the cultures of Crete and the Minoans. Between 5,800 years ago and 5,350 years ago, the Glashun culture emerged based on economies specializing in smelting copper that Sumerian cities imported from southern Levant and the copper from the upper Euphrates. The Glashuns also erected dolmen monuments and similar megalith burial structures found not only in Western Europe, but also connected to the Western Cossacks. And in the Western Cossacks, an interesting thing is there's a distribution of dolmen sites that almost looks like the 12 constellations of the zodiac. Anyways, an unexpected link for the Huyuk depressions of the Cossacks has been suggested. The fine metalwork discovered includes craftsmen in a period that could stretch from 7,000 to 5,500. And there's niches of burial in a protected valuable cultural artifacts, possibly in a sense from temple sites. Adding to the archaeological mystery are, in a sense, the metalwork period discovered far away as the Maelot burials in the north of the Black Sea. Archaeologists have suggested the Glashun contact with the Aegean and the Upper Egypt, the Armenian culture, suggests that these Eastern Mediterranean copper smelters played a dynamic role in far-flung cultures. Notably, the Glashun culture featured at the time and location linguistics suggested a proto-Semitic language first emerged approximately 5,750 years ago, probably in the Eastern Mediterranean. These later developed and became Eucratic language, Phoenician and Hebrew language, spoken not only in Canaan, but throughout the Mediterranean, Asian, Arabian Peninsula, and the Horn of Africa. In Europe, this period was less favorable. The old European civilization dissolved between 5,500 and 5,200 years ago. Despite the ancient Sumer, early Mesopotamia has already, in a sense, shown a genetic structure that affects the Sumerian expansions, reshaping the in a sense, genetic landscape. However, the potential urban centers using technology toolkits suggest that Sumer might have played a formative role in the West Eurasian history. To help establish a historical foundation for examining these multi-layered genetic structures in the Middle East, such as the forming of urban settlements during the Yubik period. And the connection or seeming connection of Sumerian populations to that of the Cossack Mountains and Asia during the Yuk period, possibly relating to current Uruks migrations, possibly relating to the spread of the Indo-European languages, and back migrations to the Fertile Crescent in response event to the Sumerian world during the Middle Bronze Age. Now, the graviton, that star related to the star of Ishtar. And Ishtar is an Arcadian Sumerian, what it would be, Iana, in Mesopotamian religion. She's a goddess of war and sexual love. Ishtar is the Arcadian counterpart to the West Semitic goddess Asher. Iana is an important goddess in the Sumerian pantheon, come to be identified with Ishtar, but it is uncertain whether Iana is also of Semitic origin or whether it is more likely, in a sense, similarities with caused by the two being somewhat identical. I think that possibly are, in a sense, emergence from an earlier, older, shared idea. In the figure of Iana, several traditions seem to have been combined. She is sometimes the daughter of the sky god An, and sometimes his wife. In other myths, she is the daughter of Nana, god of the moon, or with god of the wind, Enkil. In her earliest manifestations, she was, in a sense, associated with storehouses and the personified of goddess to that date of things like wool and meat and grain. And so, to me, she connects also to thus fertility and abundance. And the fact that she connects too to the rain or, the storms, you can see it connects to also fertility in our culture. And she was as the goddess of rain and thunderstorms, leading to her, in a sense, association with An, the god of the sky. And it was often pictured him as a lion whose roar resembled thunder, kind of like the way that they consider a bull with thunder. The power attributed to her in a war may have arisen from the connection with storms. Iana also, in a sense, is a fertility figure and goddess. Iana's, or Ishtar's, primary legacy from the Sumerian tradition is her role in fertility. She evolved, though, however, from more complex characters, surrounded by a myth of death and disaster, a goddess of contradictory seeming forces, fire and fire quenching, rejoicing in tears. The Arcadian Ishtar is also, to a greater extent, and in the sense, a deity associated with the planet Venus. With Shamash, the sun god, and Sin, the moon god, she forms the secondary ancestral and sense triad. Her popularity was universal in the ancient Mideast, and in many cultures, worshipped presumably in numerous local goddess names. In later myths, she was known as the Queen of the Universe, taking on the powers of An, Il, and Iki. The Sumerian goddess Ayana, later called in Babylonian Ishtar. Ayana was queen of the heaven. Ayana appears in more myths than any other Sumerian deity. Many of her myths involve her taking over domains of other deities. Queen of Heaven was a title given to a number of ancient sky goddesses, worshipped throughout the ancient Mediterranean and Near East during ancient times. Goddesses known to have been referred to by this title include Ayana, Arat, Isis, Ishtar, and possibly Asher by the prophet Jeremiah. In Greco-Roman times, Hera and her Roman aspect Juno bore this title. Forms and the consent of worship varied. In modern times, the title Queen of Heaven is used in contemporary pagans, generally referring to the great goddess, while Catholics and Orthodox and some Anglican Christians now simply see it as the ancient title for Mary, the mother of Jesus. Interesting. There is a connection of Ayana and Ishtar's most famous myth with the story of her descent and return from the underworld, the ancient Sumerian underworld myth, which attempts to conquer the domain of the underworld. And she is said to have come back 3 days later. Interesting. And Ayana is an ancient Mesopotamian goddess associated with love, war, fertility, justice, political power. She was originally worshipped in Sumer and was later worshipped by the Arcadians, the Babylonians, the Assyrians under other names as Ishtar. She was known as the Queen of Heaven and was the patron goddess of Ine Temple, the city of Yurk, which was her main cult center. She was associated with the planet Venus. Her most prominent symbol included a lion and the eight-pointed star. Her husband was a god, Dumnus, and her personal attendant, and was the goddess Nim-Shamer, who later became a male deity. Ayana was worshipped in Sumer at least 6,000 years ago or older. She became one of the most widely venerated deities in the Sumerian pantheon, with temples stretched across Mesopotamia. The cult of Ayana Ashtar, which may have been associated with a variety of sexual rites, includes the sexual rite of homosexuality, transvestitism, and the like, with priests, and sacred prostitution was continued by the East Semitic-speaking peoples who succeeded the Sumerians in the region. She was especially beloved by the Assyrians, who equated her to become the highest deity in their pantheon, ranking above their own national god. Ayana Ashtar alluded in the Hebrew Bible, and she is influenced the Phoenician goddess Ashtar, who later influences the development of the Greek goddess Aphrodite. Although the title Queen of Heaven often appears in many different goddesses throughout antiquity, Ayana is the one to whom the title is given the most number of times. In fact, Ayana's name is commonly derived from Nin Anna, which literally means Queen of Heaven. In ancient Sumerian, it comes into the words of Nin, meaning lady, and An, meaning sky. Although the cuneiform sign for her name is historically a figure of the two. In several myths, Anna becomes described as being the daughter of Nina, an ancient Sumerian goddess of the moon. In other texts, however, she's described as something else. There is a thing where she replies in the underworld, "I am Inanna, Queen of Heaven, on my way to the east." Her cult was deeply embedded in Mesopotamia and also among the Canaanites to the west. And as a transformation from a Venus as a male deity to Ishtar, a female goddess by the in the link with Ishtar, Tammuzud, and others like Sebel, in a sense, could be all part of a great mother goddess cult. The goddesses, the Queen of Heavens, who worshipped and Jeremiah so vehemently opposed, many have been possible. Ashtar, the name of the goddess, as known from the Northwest Semitic regions, in origin and function to the goddess of Ishtar in Mesopotamian texts. Another translation is Ashtar. Another name for the goddess include the Hebrew Ashtar. Eucratic deities. So about 5,600 years old tomb with a male burial figure, with a possibly a god, and other artifacts along with one of the first mummies that predates the first dynasty pharaohs. So sometime before the pharaohs took hold, in a sense, male gods were certainly enthroned. And there's an interesting connection, too, with the Egyptian and the language in the Sinai and Phoenician alphabet and the Greek alphabet and even Roman all seem to have a general kind of a connection. In the Egyptian society, in a sense, was a social hierarchy mixed with religion and government and culture. And the Mesopotamian social hierarchy mixed religion, government, and culture also. Starting about 5,000 years ago. So there's a humped bull figure with shaped horns and axe wielding looks like a man and a nearby man being struck down with an axe at rock paintings in ancient Indus motifs, Indus Valley like Pakistan and India. Depictions of bulls with decorated horns constitute the prominence of Indus figures, especially for the Copper Age rock art. from around 4,500 years ago in the Indus period. The hump bull obviously held a potential religious symbolism. There's an engraved eight-pointed star from the Canaanite period discovered at Tel Gezer in the foothills of the Jordan foothills, I should say, of Israel. And there's also a Canaanite culture in Israel about 3,600 years ago that seems to show a connection to both the star of Ashtar and Egyptian ideas of goddesses. Also of note, there's a ritualistic religious item seeming integrating, the scarab dating to the Canaanite period, also discovered. And Ashtar, in a sense, the Hellenized form of the Middle Eastern goddesses, Ashtar, the North Semitic, a form of Ishtar, the East Semitic, worshipped for the Bronze Age through classical antiquity, the name particularly associated with her worship in the ancient Levant among the Canaanites and the Phoenicians. She also is celebrated in Egypt following the Levant cults there. The name Ashtar is sometimes applied to cults in Mesopotamia, like Assyria and Babylon. Ashtar is one of the number of names associated with the chief goddess or female deity of those people recorded in Arcanian. The masculine form of Ishtar in Uruk and Phoenician, such as Hebrew, also has variations of the name. And then there's stuff found in the Indus Valley, dated to about 5,000 to 4,000 years ago, which seems to symbolize the victory over animal nature or over animals or a bull. And there's an interesting correlation, I think, because the, in a sense, Hebrew name of God means, in a sense, El, the basic form of God, meaning strength, mighty, or power. And just El by itself in the Bible, E-L, appears 250 times in the Old Testament. And appears primarily in construct to the God of Israel. Note that what it represents in Paleo Hebrew or pictograph Hebrew was basically like a hook, or it looks like a J, but it's like a hook and like a staff turned upside down, and a bull head with horns. So it means like strong controller, strong being the bull and controller being the staff, in a sense, meaning the word God. And the Bible God Yahweh is written in many different ways, depending on if it's pictograph Hebrew or Paleo Hebrew or if it's modern Hebrew. And so this brings you to the thought of what kind of a Jew are you? In other words, that the Judaism religion gave birth to the Christians, the Muslims, the Mormons, the Catholics, everything in a sense in between is connected to the beginning of the religion. And if you are a religious believer, may I remind you that faith in the acquisition of knowledge is not worth believing in. It is not a valid method to believe in. Because what proof is faith of anything that religions claim on faith? as many people can have different faiths even in the same religion. Historically, the Jewish religion had elements of polytheism, especially the worship of goddesses and a cult of mother goddesses as well. Asher is identified as the queen consort of the Sumerian god Anu and Eucratic El, the oldest deities of their respective pantheons, as well as that of the younger Yahweh, the god of Israel, and Judah. This role gave her similarly high rank among the Uratic pantheon, despite her associations with Yahweh. An extra biblical source, Deuteronomy 12, has Yahweh commanding the destructions of her shrines so that to mainly purify of his worship. Which, like Elet, means goddess, is clearly associated with Ashtar and the Phoenician history, because the same common epithet, Eleth, the god, a goddess par excellence, was used to describe her in Eucratic. The book of Jeremiah, written around 2,628 years ago, possibly, refers to Asher when it was using the title Queen of Heaven in Jeremiah 7:16 through 18 and Jeremiah 44:7 through 19. Asher in ancient Semitic religion is a mother goddess who appeared in a number of ancient sources. She appears in Arcadian writings by the name Atru, and in Hittite as Ashrud, or Ashrud, or Asher, generally considered identical with the Eucratic goddess. She is also called Eleth, goddess, the feminine form of El, compared to Alat, or holiness. In Arcanian texts appears the wife of Atum, the god of heaven. In contrast, she is believed to be linked to the Mesopotamian goddess Ishtar, who is sometimes saw as the daughter of Anu, while in the Eucratic myth, Ashtar is one of the daughters of El, and the West Semitic counterpart of Anu. Also, among the Hittites in Turkey, the goddesses appears as a consort of Ekenura, El of the creator of the earth, and the mother of either 77 or 88 sons, along with the Amarna letters, a king of the Amorites is named the servant of Asher. There is a William Denver, professor at the University of Arizona, has investigated the archaeology of ancient Near East for more than 30 years and offered almost as many books on the subject. And in an interview, he described some of the most significant archaeological finds relating to Hebrew Bible include the hot-button discovery of Israeli god linked to a female goddess called Asher. Thousands of clay figures have been found suggesting early Israelites worshipped more than a single god. A large image was found with the inscription, Yahweh and his Asher. Between 3,000 years ago and to the beginning of the exile, around 2,586 years ago, polytheism progressed. Organized paganism was normal throughout Israel. It was only after the exile that worship of Yahweh alone became established, and thus monotheism. And possibly only as late as the time of the Maccabees, about 2,200 years ago, that monotheism became universal among the Jews. Some biblical scholars even say that Asher at the time was worshipped as the consort or spouse of Yahweh, the national god of Israel. There are references to the worship of numerous gods throughout Kings. Solomon builds temples to many gods, and there is reported to a cutting down of Asherah statues in the temple of Solomon, built for Yahweh in 2 Kings 23:14. Joshua's grandfather had erected one such statue, as referred to in 2 Kings 21:7. Further evidence includes, for example, the 8th century combination of iconography and inscription discovered at northern Syria desert, where storage jars full of anthropomorphic figures and several inscriptions are found. The inscriptions found refer not only to Yahweh, but to El and Baal, and include the two phrases Yahweh of Samara and his Asher, Yahweh of Taham and his Asher. The reference to the capital of Israel and the capital in Edom suggests that Yahweh had a temple in Samarna while raising questions about the relationship between Yahweh and Kas, the national god of Elam. The Asher was most likely a cultic object, although the relationship with this object has sometimes been signified in connection to trees, to Yahweh and to the goddess Asher, his consort. El is unclear. It has been suggested that the Israelites might have considered Asher as a consort of Baal due to the anti-Asher iconography, which was influenced by the history in the Bible at later periods of the monarchy. Another inscription called Yahweh and his Asher appears a cow feeding a calf. If Asher is associated with Hathor, it can be assumed that the cow that is being referred to is Asher. Statue of Asher in the Iron Age, around 3,200 years ago. Asher was connected with fertility, sexuality, and war. Her symbols were the lion, the horse, and the sphinx, and a dove, along with a star within a circle indicating the planet Venus. Pictorial representations of her show her naked. Sounds almost like the Egyptian. Asher was accepted by the Greeks under the name Aphrodite. The island of Cyprus, one of the Asher's greatest faith centers, supplied the name Cyprus, probably as Aphrodite, was most common. Asher was worshipped in ancient Israel as a consort of El, or the wife of El, and in Judah as the wife of Yahweh, and the Queen of Heaven, the Hebrews baked small cakes for her at the festival. Thank you, and that's it.